Before we get into today's show, I just want to mention that the themes and the events discussed in today's show can get quite gruesome and graphic at times, so listener discretion is advised. Hello everyone, or should I say, howdy partner, and welcome to the first episode of Caleb Sue's Sick Historical Stories, the show where we look at the real people that have inspired your favourite films, TV shows, games and music. Today's episode, as you probably guessed from that introduction, is all about the Wild West and the frontiersmen that inspired Western culture.
Back when the West was young, at the last frontier, snake bites, Indian fights, plagued the pioneer.
The pioneer,
oh, at the last frontier. The last frontier, the last frontier.
Back when the law was the law of the open spaces,
the folks out there were fair and square.
They paid every debt by the sweat of their honest faces.
Yes, the title of today's episode is Frontiersmen. In today's episode, we're going to be looking at a real historical figure that inspired the main character of one of the most popular films of 2015, as well as the ideology and the real history that brought us the Wild West. We'll get into all of that in a minute, but first of all, I want to talk about the Western genre itself. The Western frontier of the early United States has been romanticized basically since its inception in the early 1800s. Immigrants and first-generation Americans on the East Coast dreamed of moving westward and building a better life for themselves. This idea that the West was a wonderful place filled with opportunity was carried through into cultural artifacts that we can look at today. One prime example of this is Laura Ingalls Wilder's best-selling and award-winning book series, Little House on the Prairie, which was first published in 1934. It's actually a biographical children's novel, which talks about her experience as a child living as part of a pioneer family. Wilder's eight-part series captured the imagination of a generation, and her books would go on to be adapted into a hit TV show from 1974 to 1983. This is far from the only example of the Western genre being popular in American and European culture, though. The Western genre was at its peak in the 40s, 50s and 60s, and has created some of the most recognisable names in film history, such as John Wayne and Clint Eastwood. Even a US president and Ronald Reagan, who made his name in the classic spaghetti westerns at the time. Since the first Western film was released in the late 1890s, the genre has been a favourite of film fans around the world, with the genre being a mainstay at the box office. Modern classics such as Quentin Tarantino's Western epic Django Unchained from 2012 and 1992's Unforgiven have kept the genre relevant, and its influence can still be seen in a number of films out with the genre, such as No Country for Old Men. And of course, you can't talk about the Wild West without at least mentioning Red Dead Redemption, which gave gamers the opportunity to play out their wildest rootin' tootin' cowboy shooting dreams. But the images these films manifest in our imaginations of cookie gold prospectors panning for gold, big strapping sheriffs out hunting bounties and serving up frontier justice, are perhaps the most iconic of them all. The lone cowboy breaking free of the constraints of civilized society and opting instead for a life wandering the Great Plains in search of adventure are so far removed from reality. Life as a frontiersman was rough, as Larry Walker, member of the American Mountain Man Society, and yes, that is a real thing, put it.
Men went to the mountains to get rich. Probably more of them died than survived, and certainly more died than got rich.
Life was especially tough for those moving westward fresh off the Louisiana Purchase in 1803. This was when the US President Thomas Jefferson bought the Louisiana Territory from France. This area stretched from modern-day Louisiana in the south to Montana on the border with Canada in the north. This single land purchase actually doubled the size of the United States at the time, and a majority of the land was totally uncharted. It was this that really kick-started the ideology of Manifest Destiny. As promised, we'll talk about Manifest Destiny just in case some folk are uncertain about what it is. Manifest Destiny was the idea that white American settlers had a divine right, a duty even, to expand the United States from the Atlantic coast in the east to the Pacific in the west. It was their role to expand westward and bring civilization to the savage native people groups. This ideology, of course, is problematic in this day and age and has a kind of social Darwinism vibe about it. But, of course, this kind of expansionist ideology wasn't uncommon for the time, especially for European settlers in America since, well, that's how they got there in the first place. It was an ideology that was symptomatic at the time.
Where the North and South folk gather, water to feed the River Grand, a grizzly bear stood up in front of a man, a sailor on the high seas. Pirate, so the story goes. Now a trapper on the high plains, trading furs for gold.
Special thanks to musician and proud South Dakotan Ken Raba for allowing us to use his music throughout today's show. The film and person I've chosen to talk about in today's show is The Revenant and a legendary mountain man, Hugh Glass. The Revenant, starring Leonardo DiCaprio and Tom Hardy, tells the story of Hugh Glass's biggest achievement, and a story which has put him in the history books forever. It's an epic tale of revenge, resilience. Some of you might have watched the film and think of yourselves as Hugh Glass experts. I'm here to tell you that you're wrong. Not only has the film added some parts of Hugh's story, like him having a son or his big shootout in the end, but they've also missed out massive parts of his life, which is of course expected, but I'm here to set the record straight. So sit back, relax, grab yourself some moonshine and a big hunk of bison. This is the story of Hugh Glass. I just want to start this off by saying that Hugh Glass was a very enigmatic man. All that we know about Hugh Glass before entering the fur trade in 1823 comes from two people. George C. Yount, who was a close friend of Glass and joined him on fur trapping expeditions, and Reverend Orange Clark, who befriended Yount and wrote of Hugh Glass's early life in his memoirs, which were published by Charles Lewis Clark in the Californian Historical Society's Quarterly Report in 1923. From Clark's memoirs, we think that Hugh Glass was born around 1783 in the Philadelphia area of Pennsylvania to Irish and Scottish parents, which, as someone with Scottish and Irish heritage myself, I'm pleased to hear. Should I come into contact with a bear anytime soon, I now know that I need not worry. This is about as much as we know about Hugh until he gets into his early 30s. This is where Hugh's wild life really begins. Hugh hears that working at sea can be lucrative and decides to take a job on a merchant ship. If you listen closely to the lyrics of that song that I played earlier in the show, you might have heard pirates being mentioned. That's because in 1817, while working at sea, Hugh's ship was plundered by pirates. And not just any pirates. Hugh's ship was plundered by one of the most notorious pirates in history, Jean Lafayette. Hugh was a highly skilled sailor and was prompted with a decision by Lafayette's crew. Either join them and help them plunder ships, or be killed. Hugh saw no other option than to join Lafayette's crew, who sailed the coast along modern-day Texas. Hugh and one other crew member from his original ship were spared, and for 2 years they were forced to take part in plunders and murder. These years of pirating took their toll on Glass and his companion, and so they planned to escape. One night, whilst anchored off the coast of Texas, the pair found themselves left alone on board the ship. They saw their opportunity and jumped overboard before swimming 2 miles to shore. They set up camp on the beach and stayed there, living off whatever they could scavenge along the shore. They were eating whatever crustaceans and edible plants they could scavenge off the land, and trying their best to avoid hostile Native Americans that actually used to patrol the coast of Texas in search of pirates. Glass and his companion then trekked an estimated 1,000 miles through the Great Central American Plains before encountering a hostile tribe of Wolf Pawnee Native Americans.
Woo!
The wolf Pawnee, native to the Kansas area where Hugh and his companion were captured, were known to be hostile. This particular tribe were infamous for their brutal human sacrifices, which they believed brought them fertile land. Hugh and his companion were brought before the tribe's chief, who decided that Glass's companion would be the first to be sacrificed. The nameless companion was hung upside down by his ankles and pierced with hundreds of pine needles, which were then lit on fire and burned him alive. Hugh knew that if he didn't act quickly, he would meet the same fate. So Hugh reached into his pocket and produced a bag of vermilion and offered it to the tribe's chief. Vermilion is a mineral that's been used since the ancient Romans as a dye and to make paint. And it was valuable to Native Americans in the early 1800s. And luckily, the chief took the vermilion as a sign from the gods to spare Hugh's life. In fact, the gesture was seen as so divine by the chief, they adopted Hugh as his own. Hugh then lived with the Pawnee for several years and totally integrated into the tribe's culture. He learned how to live off the land, he learned their language, he married a Pawnee lady, even fought alongside the Pawnee in battles against other tribes and frontiersmen.
When Louis came home to the flats, he hung up his coat and his hat. He gazed all around, but no wifey he found, so he said, "Where can Flossie be at?" A note on the table he spied. He read it just once, then he cried. It ran, "Louis dear, it's too slow for me here, so I think I will go for a ride. Meet me in St. Louis, Louis."
In the early 1820s, the first big industry boom in the United States happened when the Louisiana Territory opened up the Missouri and Mississippi rivers for fur trappers. Beaver pelt, which was easily caught along the banks of these rivers, was incorporated into high fashion in Europe and were going for a premium price. It's unclear exactly how Hugh Glass got from Kansas to St. Louis, but it's in taking a job advertising the Missouri Gazette in 1822 that he entered into the fur trade. The advertisement was posted by William Ashley, a decorated Missouri militia general looking to make some money out of the new booming industry. Ashley called for 100 enterprising men to take part in a 3-year-long trapping expedition into what was at the time uncharted territory. He had planned to charter 2 boats up to the source of the Missouri River and then onwards overland to the Rocky Mountains. It was in the summer of 1823, Hugh Glass and 99 other men ventured off into the wilderness with hopes of becoming rich. Along the way, Ashley's 100 came into contact with a Native American tribe along the Missouri called the Arikara, who had gained a reputation for being unpredictable. In some cases, they had built good relationships with frontiersmen, and in others, they had used their knowledge of the land to murder traders and rob their pelts. Ashley approached the Arikara at one of their settlements along the Missouri on the 30th of May 1823 to try and barter for horses. The tribe weren't open to talking, however, as they had just lost 3 warriors in a skirmish with another fur company. Ashley was in dire need of horses, though, so that his men could make over the land faster and collect more pelts. So he offered the Arikara a gift as a goodwill gesture to try and open up negotiations. But the gesture was taken differently by the tribe, who saw it as an admission of guilt and the gift as reparations. It did the job in a way. After taking the gifts, the tribe traded 19 horses for 15 muskets and ammunition, which, for the time period, was actually quite a good bargain. Ashley left in high spirits, having gotten his horses, not knowing what was to come. And what followed was 2 battles with the Arikara, which left the tribe homeless and bitter, and Ashley 25 men down without a single pelt. William Ashley and his business partner Andrew Henry had a crisis meeting following these 2 battles. The company was in danger of shutting down because of the amount of debt they had accrued on their unsuccessful expedition up the Missouri. Their experiences hadn't totally turned them off though. They devised a plan to get their men up to the Rocky Mountains where they would be able to trap for fur and make some of their money back. To do this, the remaining men would have to trek hundreds of miles through forests and mountains into Montana. So on August 8th, 1823, William Ashley returned to St. Louis and was replaced by an experienced tracker called Jedediah Smith. On the same day, the remaining men set off from Fort Atkinson on the banks of the Missouri River and headed west to the Rocky Mountains. It was 12 days into this expedition that Hugh Glass would meet the beast that cemented his place in history. Glass, Jedediah Smith, and George Yount were appointed as hunters by Andrew Henry. Both Smith and Yount were given the roles because of their experiences working in the area with other fur traders. Hugh, however, took on the role because of his life experiences up to 1823. I've got a little excerpt here from John Myers Myers' book about Hugh Glass, where he talks about how the other men on the expedition saw him. It's quite a lengthy one, but bear with me. I think it gives you really good insight into the character of Hugh Glass. So it reads, Hugh Glass shrugged off orders and picked his own path through the country he wished to inspect with no one in his hair. The man who did this had been shaped by forces which made it natural for him to be at once indifferent to the opinions of others and careless of his own skin. He had had what might be called four incarnations. So separate each other were the four epochs of his career. There had been the pre-Western experience of which he never spoke beyond saying that he had been a mariner. On the doorstep of middle age, he had been pared away from any associations he had as a decent seafaring man and had wallowed in slime beneath the skull and crossbones. Escaped corruption, he had been dragged back to the Neolithic era by the Wolf Pawnee. Now he climbed halfway back up centuries roving with other homeless white hunters. The man who had survived to make this comeback was bound to have grown calluses where once had nerves. And Yount said as much through Reverend Clark when he described Glass as bold, daring, reckless, and eccentric to a high degree, but was nevertheless a man of great talents and intellectual as well as bodily power. But this bravery was conspicuous beyond all other qualities for the perilous life he led. I did warn you that it was a lengthy one, but I think it really tells us a lot about Hugh Glass. In short, Hugh Glass had had a hard life and lived through some awful things that made him kind of unhinged, maybe. Definitely a bit of a hermit, if nothing else. Anyway, Hermit Glass insisted on hunting alone. He strayed off the path that was set for him by his hunting partner Smith and Yount, and on the 20th of August 1823, it led him into the jaws of a mother grizzly bear. Hugh was hunting ahead of the rest of the group, but was still within eyesight of Smith, Yount, and a third man who went by the name Hall when he encountered the bear. I realise this part of the show is getting a bit excerpt heavy, but I have here an actual eyewitness account from Hall who saw Hugh Glass being attacked by the bear. Hall wrote of how Glass only realised that the bear was present when he saw cubs, and by that time it was too late. Anyway, this is how his account reads. Before he could set his trigger, he was seized by the throat and raised from the ground. Casting him again upon the earth, his grim adversary tore out a mouthful of cannibal food and retired to submit a sample to her yearling cubs, which were near at hand. The sufferer now made an effort to escape, but the bear immediately returned and seized him again at the shoulder. She also lacerated his left arm very much and inflicted a severe wound on the back of his head. From other accounts from Yount and Smith, we also know that at one point Glass was able to get a shot off, and that was more than likely what it was that saved his life. The attack was brutal and left Glass with a broken leg, lacerations all over his body, and an open wound from between his shoulder blades to the bottom of his back. Men who were part of Henry's group reported that the only indication that Glass was alive was the occasional grunt and some eye movement. He was in such a rough state that most of the men didn't expect Glass to make it through the night.
He left his youth behind many years ago on this late day in August. He faced his grisly foe. Knife met claw, tooth met bone. He feared his final breath. This was not his beginning. It would not be his end.
As we heard in the excerpt I read about Hugh Glass earlier, the men, despite thinking that it was a bit weird, had a lot of respect for Glass. They decided it would have been wrong for them to kill him. Despite his wounds, after all the adversity he'd come through to get to this point where he was still alive after literally fighting a bear. So the men built him a stretcher and decided to continue carrying Hugh with them as they continued their journey to Fort Henry at the foot of the Yellowstone River near the Rocky Mountains. 5 days in, Hugh Glass was still alive, but carrying him was slowing down the men quite a lot. Henry was worried at the possibility of another Arikara attack, especially since Ashley and his reinforcements destroyed their settlement on the Missouri River. They were sure to be wandering the landscape and were even more likely to not be very friendly. So Henry decided that two men should stay with Glass until he passed away naturally, and that the rest of the group would continue along their trail. He offered $80, which was the equivalent of $2,000 today, to two men who would stay with Glass until he died. Two men stepped forward, assuming it would be an easy task for them, God knows why, especially after him surviving 5 days, but hey-ho. John Fitzgerald, who's played by Tom Hardy in the film The Revenant, and Jim Bridger volunteered to stay with Hugh. Another 5 days pass and Hugh Glass is still alive. At this point, John Fitzgerald gets restless, it seems. According to Hugh himself, Fitzgerald convinced the much younger Bridger that they had done their job and that they'd stayed with Glass much longer than any of the others would have. Bridger was apparently hesitant but was intimidated by Fitzgerald and eventually went along with him. Before the men abandoned Hugh, however, they took his knife, his tomahawk, fire-making kit and his prized rifle, leaving him with only a straight razor he carried in an old gunpowder pouch. What we know of what happened to Hugh when he was left by Fitzgerald and Bridger comes from a conversation with Hugh later on in Hugh's life. Of course, there are loads of things that could have affected Hugh's memory when he was recounting his experiences. For one, the men spoke of him slipping in and out of what we now know was a coma. And secondly, he had a fever, so hallucinations were very likely, which might explain why Hugh was adamant that a wolf had untied him from his stretcher, which is how he got off. Hugh's story of survival from here is genuinely one of the wildest things I've ever read about in my life, which isn't really saying much because I'm not a massive reader, but it would be hard for anything to beat it anyway. Hugh, motivated by pure rage and a burning desire for revenge, managed to crawl and sail 250 miles back to the Missouri River, back to Fort Kiowa. It was deserted by a small spring which was surrounded by buffalo berries. Hugh used the spring water and the buffalo berries to nurse himself back to health. He spoke about making a kind of berry paste or maybe more of a smoothie using spring water and the buffalo berries. It was the only thing that he could get down his mutilated throat. So he lay there on his stretcher for another few days eating his berry paste and thinking about how he was going to kill the two men who had left him there to die alone. Hugh still wasn't up off his stretcher by this point. It wasn't until he managed to kill a rattlesnake and make a kind of cold snake stew the same way he'd been making his berry smoothies that he was able to muster up enough strength to start crawling. Initially he tried to follow a path that had been laid for him by Henry's expedition, but it was too treacherous and he had to stay near a sure water supply so that he could stay hydrated and he had something to soak his food in. Whilst crawling along one of the springs that led back to the Missouri proper, he came across a pack of wolves attacking a stray buffalo calf. He waited until the wolves had had their way with the calf before he crawled over to feed off of what was left. He posted up there for a little while, allowing the meat to digest for a bit, and it seemed to fuel him enough so that he could stand up. His biggest break came in the form of a group of Lakota Native Americans along the shore of the Missouri. The Lakota men in the group recognised Hugh as one of William Ashley's men, since Ashley had hired some of the Lakota to fight for him during his second battle with the Arikara. They gave him a boat, and he sailed the remainder of his journey about 100 miles to Fort Kiowa. By October 1823, Hugh Glass had fought a bear, fought off death, been abandoned to die alone, lived off of plants, berries, snakes, a buffalo carcass. He crawled and hobbled over 100 miles through the wilderness and then sailed another 100 miles. I'm sorry, but that is the maddest thing, full stop. Hugh Glass was another level of madman. So, what happened to Hugh Glass after his tale of survival against all odds? Did he get his revenge? Was there a big shootout with John Fitzgerald just like in the movie? Well, the short answer is no. The longer answer is, he took time to heal up properly at Fort Kiowa, but then Glass was able to track down Jim Bridger, but he showed him mercy because of his age. As for John Fitzgerald, he joined the US Army, so there was nothing Hugh Glass could do there, so he went back to trapping for a few years after his expedition with Ashley, and was killed by a group of Arikara at Fort Cass in 1833. After the events of the summer and autumn of 1823, Hugh Glass became a frontier legend. Although it would take almost another 100 years for Hugh to become a semi-well-known figure by the historical community, and another 100 on top of that for him to become an iconic figure and symbol of the Wild West, mountain men and frontier living. He was a true rugged adventurer. The story of Hugh Glass is one of adversity. It's a story of resilience, real adventure, a story of bravery, hope, revenge, and forgiveness. And to be honest with you, I'd choose the real story over the film any day. Thank you all for listening to the first episode of Caleb Stew's Sick Historical Stories. I hope you've enjoyed listening to it as much as I enjoyed researching and actually making it. I want to take a wee second here to thank Ken Raba, who's the musician who wrote and performed the song about Hugh Glass you've heard throughout today's episode. I'm going to leave links to all of his socials in the description so you can check out his work. Not only is he a super cool, down-to-earth and interesting guy, but he's also a super talented musician. So you can go and check him out and tell him that I sent you. Don't forget to subscribe if you're on YouTube and to follow if you guys are listening on SoundCloud. But yeah, cheers guys. Tune in next time where we're going to be talking about pirates. Bye.